Hello, John Talley here with Partzilla.com, and boy, am I deep in the middle of a project today. This is our next installment, rebuilding the motor on our 2012 Polaris RZR 900 XP. It really needed a lot of help. So here's what we're up against today. We've got the block. This is the centerpiece of it all. We've got all these other parts that came off of it. Some we're going to be able to use, some we are not. On this table, we have an enormous amount of parts, brand new, just arrived and ready to be used if need be. Well, we're going to figure out which ones we need and which ones we don't. So let me go grab a couple of toolboxes and we'll get started. All right, guys, step number one in all of this. We need to get all our bearings sized correctly. So there's a chart inside of the Polaris manual. So here's how this works. We're going to start off with sizing the mains first, but we need to get some information off our block and off our crankshaft. On our block on the end, you're going to have six numbers, so you need to write those down. And on the crankshaft, because we're putting in a new one, they're going to be stamped right here. Now this is going to be a set of letters. Write this down as well. Chances are it ain't going to be just like mine, because each one of these are unique. That's why Polaris goes through the pain of actually sizing all of this for us. Using a chart, we can determine which bearing goes in. All right, with that information, my particular crankshaft, just on the mains, is going to be G, B, G, G. All right, off the block, it's all threes. So, using our chart for the main bearings, a G3 is going to be a yellow. A B3 is going to be green. Looking at your bearings, this is going to be yellow. You're going to have a green one here, and then two more yellows on the end. That will complete just the main bearings. All right, next, we need to size the connector rods. Our old one, the one that we're going to reuse, has a number on the end cap, which is a 3. All right, our new one has a 2. So, going to the connecting rod chart, a B2 is going to be a blue bearing. A B3 is going to be a green bearing. Before we actually lay the crankshaft in, I want to go ahead and prepare the pistons connector rods. And as you found out before, it was the connector rod that actually caused all this to go so horribly wrong. So what we need to do is go ahead and pull it out of the bore and get this one replaced. Looking at the piston, it's practically perfect. You can tell that was brand new when whomever built this thing and did this part wrong. So let's get that circlip out of there, get the old connector rod off, and then get it put back together. Want to make sure you put it back in the same orientation. Each one has a serial number on the end of it. Just make sure that goes back the same way it came off. Reach in and grab that edge, pop it right out. All right, we've got a new circlip here. The wrist pin looks good. I mean, just no wear on that at all, so we're just going to reuse it. Little dab of oil. Delta T's there. Serial number's facing me. That's the way the other one came off. Let's put the clip right here. You do not want that edge or the end of it to go inside that channel. But what you do want to use that channel to ride it over. Once you get that other edge in, then you can use just regular screwdriver, push down the back edge and get it to snap in. All right, let's get these rings back in the right orientation. It basically just alternates back and forth, going fore and aft on the piston as far as the rings go. All right, piston still has a little bit of oil on it. You want that delta T to end up pointing to the exhaust side. So that's going to be over here. So it needs to go in like this. All right. Let's go and get this end cap out of the way. Go and get our base gasket in place before we put the pistons and the cylinders over there. Need to get one half of the bearing on each one, and hopefully you've been keeping this organized. I tend to lay things out on the table to where they swing over to where they should go. All right, just a little dab of oil in here. Let's go ahead and set it on the block. What we're going to do is just use this plate. What we're going to do is put it in the center. Then I'm going to use a couple of head bolts, just with some sockets as extensions. And we're just going to do it hand tight to hold it all in place so we can rotate the engine upside down to get the crankshaft in. And now let's rotate it around. All right, so this is going to be surfaces 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we want to go ahead and get the bearings in for 1, 3, 5, and 6. That's going to be our mains. Yellow, green, yellow, yellow. All right, right there, you can see just a little bit of yellow. So that's what we want. This one should be green. And two more yellows. All right, next, we're going to go ahead and dab each one of those bearings with a little bit of oil. All right, before we put our crank in, we need to go ahead and put this oil diverter in. It just slides in right here. Now, let's go ahead and get our chains on the crankshaft, as well as our output seal. All right. That looks like it. Next, we're going to go ahead and get the end caps on. Make sure that your serial numbers line up and are with the right one. This one is actually a connector rod that we're reusing, but we are using new connector rod bolts. A little bit of oil. It can be a little bit tricky to get the other one because it's kind of buried down there. And of course, it came with new bolts. At this point, we're going to go ahead and torque down the connector rod bolts, and then we'll address getting the counterbalancer in there. All right, this is actually a two-stage setup. First stage, using a torque wrench, take it to 13 foot-pounds. Now we want to take it another 105 degrees. When it's pointing this direction, it's going to be 90, and then we go want to know another 15. So about right here where this mark is. So that's where we want to end up. Now I know they make dial indicators for this type of procedure. I just don't happen to have one with me right now. That should be it about right there. It's plus or minus 3 degrees, so that gives you a pretty good window to at least get it in there. Let's see if we can rotate the other one up and do the same thing. Let's go ahead and get our bearings in. We're using the same ones that came out of it. Go ahead and dab a little oil in there so it isn't starving on startup. All right, let's get that counterbalance shaft in there. The alignment dot is actually right here. And that's gonna line up with our counterbalance, which is right there. So those are the two points we're gonna wanna line up looking through here. There she goes. All right, and they're still lined up. So that's where it needs to be. All right, next, we need to go ahead and get our bearings in on the bottom half of our crankcase. And I've got them laid out here in the same orientation as I put those other ones on. Going here, 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 and here, those four should be yellow, green, yellow, yellow. And then we've got the two originals that came out of the counterbalance. And they go here and here. All right, guys, what we need to do next is apply the sealant path to the upper cover. As you can see in the drawing, it's got a very specific path that it needs to follow. You want to be very careful not to get any in this channel, because that's actually an oil passageway. And this doesn't take a lot. It's just going to be a thin, consistent layer all the way around this side, and then all the way around that side. All right, now we just want to look around, make sure there's no big gaps anywhere. It looks like she seated all the way down. Let's get those M10 bolts in place. And yes, they do want you to use new ones. All right, let me show you the torque sequence on these bolts. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. We want to torque it on the first stage to 21 foot-pounds. For the second stage, we just want to tighten each bolt in the same sequence, 90 degrees. All right, next we need to put in the M8 bolts. There's only two of them, and there's just a single stage to tighten them down, and it's 26 foot-pounds. Now you've got one lone bolt over here, and it's only set to 106 inch-pounds. Let's go ahead and rotate the engine back up and get those upper bolts in. What I'm gonna do is just go ahead and put them in, bottom them out, you know, just do them just snug, and then we'll torque them. We're gonna start over here with number 12 and take it to 26 foot-pounds. Next is number 13, 26 foot-pounds as well. Now the rest of them, the little 8mm head bolts, it's only like 89 inch-pounds. If you don't have a torque wrench when you're doing these smaller ones that'll go down that far, you wanna make sure you grab up toward the head of the ratchet and not out at the end so you don't over-torque it. Next, let's go ahead and get our oil pump on. Once she slides into position, now you can go ahead and put those dowels in. After that, then you just put in the three 10mm bolts. And those, if you've got a good enough torque wrench, are set to 89 inch-pounds. All right, with this amount of damage that this engine had, we needed to take these screens off and make sure that we got every little last bit of metal that was ground up inside of it. Make sure their O-rings are in good shape when you're putting these back in. Then you just have these little C-clamps held in by a 10mm that holds the whole thing together. All right, guys, next step, let's go ahead and get this oil sump pan reinstalled. I've got the surface all cleaned off and ready to go. Just need to grab our gasket. There's no glue required here. If you were having to do this on the unit, you'd want to put just a little bit on the surface to hold it to the bottom. But since we've got gravity working for us, we can just lay it in place. All right, next we're just gonna hand start all these little 8mm bolts. And then of course, there is a very specific tightening sequence that we're gonna need to go through. All right, well there's your sequence. Let's go ahead and get them torqued down. And that is actually to 106 inch-pounds. When you're tightening this, you do not wanna put your hand on the end of the socket, because that'll skew the amount of torque, especially when you're dealing with something that's so low. All right, now that we've gotten all this tightened down, let's go back and just recheck one and two, make sure they've still got enough torque on them. Yeah, we're good. Well, all right, guys, that pretty much finishes up the bottom end of this engine build. What's next? Well, we need to go ahead and get the head set up, get those valves lapped in, get it installed, set the timing, then get out all the other pieces put on, like the flywheel and the cover box for the magneto. So, follow us over to the next video, and I'll show you how to get that done. And until then, we just want to say thanks for watching.